So first of all, I would thank the PVI. I would like to thank the IPC team for letting me to present this, and I would also like to wish a very good afternoon, good morning, or good evening, wherever you are based out of. I'm going to talk about remote pharmacovigilance inspections. Until last year, if we were supposed to talk about inspections and audits, first thing which would come to our mind would be travel. That we should pack our bags, wear our blazers, and move out and go to inspect various companies. But now things have changed. And especially with the COVID scenario, things have changed much more. And even there is visibility with regards to the regulatory authorities. What does the MHRA say? That under such situations, that is the pandemics or the natural disasters, virtual or distant remote pharmacovigilance inspections could replace on-site inspections. The same holds true even with MHRA. So even MHRA believes that a remote inspection is as effective as an on-site pharmacovigilance inspection. What are the various phases of remote pharmacovigilance audit? The first phase is the announcement phase, wherein you would notify the other party that you would like to inspect them or audit them. The next and the most important is the technical preparation, which we would discuss in the subsequent slides. Technical preparation is the most important. Today we are all viewing this presentation remotely. So that is again one of the enhancements, I would say, with the COVID scenario, wherein most of the conferences are also happening remotely. The next is the pre-audit documentation, wherein you talk about the data request, what something which you would review, and based on that you would inspect or audit somebody. And this is extremely important because we are talking about remote audits, wherein you need more and more data requests before the audit. You can review them, and then you can be to the point that I want to ask for this and this document, or else which area I should focus on. The next is the preparation phase. Preparation is for both, for the auditors as well as the auditees. And then the main part, which is the audit conduct. And finally, it is the reporting and closure of the audit or inspection. So we'll now talk about the technical preparation. As I said, this is the most important exercise for a remote audit or inspection. The first part is teleconference, wherein you would audit somebody, but then it will, you will only have one medium of discussion, and that will be through telecom. You would only be able to hear the auditees and the auditors, nothing beyond that. The next will be, can be a web-based presentation, something similar to what is happening right now, wherein you are all able to see the presentation. So something like that. Or else you can have something like a video conferences, wherein in video conferencing, the auditee and the auditors are all able to see each other. Then one more interesting, which is virtual reality. And this also is happening or gaining momentum nowadays, wherein if the FDA or the MHRA wants to undertake remote remote inspection, or probably the GMP inspection, they can even do that through virtual reality, wherein you would be able to view the manufacturing location. So even that is slowly becoming reality. And in case of pharmacovigilance, this can even be useful if somebody wants to evaluate the archival processes and so on. And the last one is the most frequent, which is the combination methods, wherein you can use teleconference for the exchange of words, and you can also have something which is video conference. So nowadays people prefer combination methods. What are the various advantages of remote audit? The first advantage is you save on the travel cost. The travel cost, again, you, if there is an auditor, they would request for a business class travel. Then again, you need to spend so much on travel. Then again, accommodation, or maybe a 3-star or a 5-star hotel. And then the overall cost may be much higher in case of on-site inspection. And all these things can be saved using the remote audit. The next advantage is that you can have multiple auditees, and you can also have multiple auditors, and all of them can coordinate remotely. For example, if I'm getting inspected by the MHRA, it is possible that the MHRA inspectors are also at different locations, and even my team is in various locations, and then even that can be coordinated. The third advantage is it is very easy to reschedule. So if somebody has booked for travel and accommodation, and somebody says, no, last moment there is some problem, you can easily reschedule. Absolutely no problem. You don't need to worry about cancellation charges or even hotel availability. Absolutely no problem. The fourth advantage is that you can also record audits and inspections, provided you have consent from the auditors. So even that is possible, and you ultimately generate evidence that what was being discussed, and if in case you have recorded, you obviously have evidence. The last advantage is it is quite convenient, remote audit. Then you can also take care of the time zone issues, wherein if somebody is in India and somebody is in Australia, or somebody is in the UK or the US, so time zone can also be managed, especially if there are multiple people in different time zones. The best part is jet lag. Jet lag, you don't need to worry about jet lag, that you travel all the way to some country and you feel jet lag for a few days, and then you would be ready to participate in the on-site inspection. You don't need to worry about all those things in the remote audit or inspection. But then, yes, there are also some disadvantages with the remote audits. The first and foremost is the body language. As an auditor, I always used to feel that if I'm talking to somebody and looking at their eye movements and the way they behave, I would be able to gauge that somebody is going telling the truth or not. But this is unfortunately not possible during remote inspections. The focus and coordination may be difficult, wherein if somebody is undertaking the remote inspection and suddenly they have a phone call, and the temptation to take the call will be much more than if it is a on-site inspection or audit. Again, it is very difficult to deep dive into any issue which you identify, because you, that is paucity of time, and it is also not possible because there are no people available at any of the ends. It becomes difficult. Next is data integrity compliance. It is absolutely difficult to evaluate during remote audits. If in case somebody has signed something, you don't know whether it is a scanned copy or is it a really, it is a wet signature. You will not be able to assess during remote audits or inspection. So that is quite difficult to assess the data integrity compliance. The next one is if there are too many documents, it will not be possible to evaluate during remote audits or inspections. That may be a challenge, but then to some extent you can foresee this and try to prepare yourself during the pre-audit request. There is too much time required in preparing that how I am going to undertake the audit or how I am going to face the audit. So everything, it takes too much of a time. And at the end of the day, you'll still be not completely prepared. And this generally happens. There are also some risks associated with remote audits and inspection. The first risk is with regards to technology. Again, today we saw that because of technology, we had some delays with regards to the presentations. And IT connectivity is absolutely important. If anything goes wrong, anything gets delayed, it's a problem. and you need to have very good internet connectivity. Nowadays, everybody is working from home. There is a lot of issues with regards to the bandwidth. And if you are undertaking the audit through in the office, then again, there are colleagues who are again using the internet. So that can be a risk which needs to be considered. The second one is acceptability. There are many accreditation bodies which do not accept remote audits. They only want physical or on-site audits. So this is something which is slowly changing, and all regulators are also okay with remote audits and inspection. And the final risk is with regards to the reliability of observations and also ethics. So now regulators are also playing very smart. They are straight away mentioning that if in case we are not happy with the remote audit, we may consider an on-site inspection subsequently. So there is a disclaimer always during the remote audits nowadays. You also have some kind of caution that needs to be exercised during remote audits and inspection. And this is especially for the auditees. The first caution is with regards to the access control. That imagine you are an auditee and the auditor says that show me this document, and you say, okay, I give you control, you can see this document. And that's a risk. They can look into anything, or they can inadvertently find something which you didn't want to show. So even that can be possible. But then at the level of transparency, to some extent, this may not be possible as well. But to a greater extent, it is under your control. The next is recording without consent. So if you are getting audited or inspected, you definitely need to take consent from the auditor whether you can record or not. You cannot just record and then say, no, you didn't say this or you didn't ask this. Absolutely not. This is not acceptable. And finally, you may have issues with regards to untrained team, wherein the team doesn't know how to participate in a remote audit or inspection, and then you end up with a problem. Again, everything can be managed with proper planning and care. So there are no right or wrong practices with regards to remote audits and inspection, but we would still like to talk about a few things. First is, we can have a guideline for remote audits. Every company or every organization should have definitive guidelines for remote audits and inspections. It is absolutely essential to have advanced testing. Even with the regulators, so you can request them that we would like to undertake testing well in advance, just to check everything is going on well. Absolutely, you need to be well prepared. As we always say, that if you are well prepared, then your work is half done. So this is the way it works, that you have to be absolutely well prepared with regards to a remote audit or inspection. Documentation is absolutely important. You should have everything in place and everything online. You cannot say that, okay, somebody is asking something, okay, I'll go and scan anything. It will take time. So you need to be well prepared with documentation. And finally, you need to have efficient systems, be it IT or non-IT, or even if you're using something like a Google Meet, or you are using something like a Zoom, everything, you should have everything well tested and working. So remote audits are a viable alternative, and gradually there is a lot of acceptability as well. You need very strong infrastructure in place, that if you are wanting to do something, you need to have a telecom system, a well-functioning laptop camera, or you want to use a video conferencing system, it should be well-functioning. Technical preparation, as I said, it's the most important during remote audit and inspection. You cannot live without it. And then preparedness. You need to be well prepared. And with that, your half the work will be done. What I believe is the remote audits can lead to surge in inspections, because the regulators are also saving a lot of time with travel. So you never know. Someday they would think of auditing two companies on Monday, or they can do it continuously or 5 days a week, all 5 days they can inspect companies. Even that can happen. So we need to see how it goes in the future. But then the remote audits and inspections are here to stay. So with this, I come to the end of my presentation.